There are many factors that influence the choice of dressings and wound treatments. Personal experience and the influence of colleagues, treatment approaches which give good results in the past, traditional knowledge and practice successfully passed down through generations of practitioners, and can perpetuate poor practice and myth. Selection of wound dressings is dependent on many factors. Some of these factors are related to the dressings, properties, cost effectiveness, wear time, availability and ease of use. Others are related to the wound, exudate, necrotic tissue, infection, odor, size, shape and depth, also location and the peri-wound skin condition. Also, there are some factors related to the clinician: knowledge, practical skills, confidence, competence, willingness to consult others. Also, there are other factors related to the patient himself: preference, previous experience, cost effectiveness, ease of use, and also dexterity or mobility. Factors related to the organization: care environment, support, change, cohesive multidisciplinary team, standardization of best practice. So, the characteristics of ideal dressings were identified many years ago. The ideal dressing has yet to be developed. So, each year as more products are launched into an already crowded market, the choice of dressings becomes more confusing. The ideal dressings should have the following properties: permeability, to control the rate of air exposure and the gaseous exchange between the wound and the outside environment; transparency, to allow monitoring of any fluid accumulation and other complications; the ability to remain in situ during bathing; low adherence, to facilitate removal from susceptible thin skin; and the ability to act as complete barrier to bacteria and water, but not to moisture vapor. Dressings are often classified in generic groups according to their function, though this is continually evolving and is subject to change. Broadly, they can be divided into two groups: passive, inert, and interactive products. The passive inert products may be absorbing or non-absorbing, while the interactive products modify the local wound environment to promote moisture balance by absorbing and or retaining wound exudate. Honey has been used in wounds since ancient times, but medical grade honey dressings was developed in the late 1990s. Honey has a broad spectrum of activity against bacteria, including methicillin resistant Staph aureus and vancomycin resistant Enterococcus. The antimicrobial activity of honey is thought to be due to a number of factors, including the ability of honey to produce low levels of hydrogen peroxide in the wound, the provision of an acidic wound environment, the pH may be 3, and sugar molecules bind to water molecules, removing the bacterial food source. Medical grade honey dressings are antimicrobial, reduce wound odor, absorb low to moderate exudate, promote autolytic debridement, effective debriding agents, create a moist wound dressing interface, and are comfortable and also flexible. Medical grade honey dressings are sometimes associated with localized pain, require no secondary dressings, and are available in various formulations, for example, sheets, pastes, ointments, or combined with alginates. Honey dressings are indicated for critically colonized or infected wounds, low to moderate exudating wounds, and appropriate for use in diabetic patients. However, it's contraindicated in patients with known allergy to bee stings, highly exudating wounds, and also it may cause stinging sensation. If so, you have to discontinue this type of dressings. It's better to keep in mind that gauze should not be used as a primary wound contact layer, as it dehydrates the wound bed and dries out to form a hard mass that causes trauma to newly formed granulation tissue and fresh bleeding when removed. Gauze products are not waterproof and don't provide an effective barrier to invading microorganisms. Foam dressings are good alternative to gauze in terms of pain reduction, patient satisfaction, and savings in nursing time. Selection of foam dressings is a complex activity, requiring a range of skills that include matching local conditions at the wound bed to the most appropriate dressing, and a critical understanding of the principles of dressing management and the evidence supporting manufacturers' claims. Negative pressure wound therapy is also known as sub-atmospheric pressure, topical negative pressure, vacuum-assisted closure, and micro-deformational wound therapy. Since its introduction in clinical practice in the early 1990s, negative pressure wound therapy has become widely used in the management of complex wounds in both inpatient and outpatient care. Simply, the method consists of application of negative pressure, usually -75 to -125 mmHg, to a foam that has been placed inside the wound. Immediate sealing of the wound with an airtight adhesive drape prevents subsequent entry of air from the environment, and hence the term vacuum sealing. Negative pressure wound therapy is sought to promote wound healing through stimulating wound contraction and blood flow at the wound edge, improving interstitial fluid flow, wound perfusion, protease profiles, growth factor, and cytokine expression, leading to improved wound healing. So, the mechanism of action of negative pressure wound therapy is through reduction of the wound area due to negative pressure acting on the foam pulls together the edges of the wound, resulting in wound contraction. Stimulation of granulation tissue formation in an optimally moist wound environment. In several situations, even over bradytrophic tissue such as tendon and bone, negative pressure wound therapy was able to stimulate granulation tissue formation. As well, negative pressure wound therapy leads to continuation of the effective mechanical wound cleansing, removal of small tissue debris by suction. Also, effective biochemical reduction of the fluid concentration of wound healing impairing proteases, such as elastase, in the first days. Negative pressure wound therapy also favors continuous removal of wound exudate and consequently few dressing changes within a closed system. Pressure-related reduction of interstitial edema with consecutive improvement of microcirculation, stimulation of blood flow, and oxygenation of the tissues. We'll be right back. The vacuum assisted closure system consists of black semi-occlusive dressing, semi-permeable drape used to isolate the wound, suction tubing and suction ports, collection canister, and the vacuum pump. However, negative pressure on therapy is contraindicated in the following situations: necrotic tissue with hard scar or thick slow, untreated osteomyelitis, malignancy in the wound, exposed vasculature or nerves, non-enteric and unexplored fistulas, exposed anastomotic site, and exposed organs. The advantages of hyperbaric oxygen therapy can be emphasized in four main categories, namely mechanical, bacteriostatic, intoxication, and hypoxia healing effects. Hyperbaric oxygen has two main effects on the body: mechanical effects on body gases, achieving an increase in partial oxygen pressure. However, the therapeutic efficacy of this therapy in most cases depends mainly on these two main effects. Hyperbaric oxygen therapy is generally applied once or twice a day for 45 to 120 minutes at an atmospheric pressure changing from 1.5 to 3, changing according to the character of the case in single or multiple occupancy hyperbaric chambers. Hyperbaric oxygen therapy was first used in the 1960s as an adjunctive to the standard treatment modalities for wound healing. The troublesome wound healing is in any case due to chronic hypoxia. The benefits of hyperbaric treatment are derived from its systemic delivery. This means there is no topical effect of oxygen on cutaneous wound healing. Today's goal is not to employ hyperbaric oxygen therapy to heal the wound per se. Rather, it's used to normalize the environment around the wound by producing a critical mass of angiogenesis. In the inflammatory stage of wound healing, hyperbaric oxygen therapy increases oxygenation and hence assists neutrophil to kill bacteria in the hypoxic wound region. Oxygen is not only an important energy supply, but also acts as antibacterial. Recent studies proved that almost all the cells in the wounded region possesses some specific enzymes that can transform oxygen to reactive oxygen species. These reactive oxygen species also assist intercellular correspondence and support wound healing in this way. When partial oxygen pressure in tissues rises from 10 mm mercury to 40, collagen synthesis increases sevenfold. Increased oxygen does not cause extreme healing. This concept is rather related with the speed of the healing procedure. Conclusively, the beneficial mechanisms of action of hyperbaric oxygen results from direct pressure, mass action of gases, new vascularization, antimicrobial, vasoconstriction, hyperoxygenation, attenuation of reperfusion injury. In essence, hyperbaric oxygen therapy consists of delivering to patients pure oxygen gas at pressure levels higher than normal pressures.